Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome here at the Faber Studio in St. Anna Parochie at this third and last theme night of the Media Art Festival 2020. As you may already know, the festival itself, unfortunately, cannot take place for obvious reasons concerning COVID-19. The festival organization is still working hard and trying hard to make the festival take place coming year, starting at the 26th of February 2021. So for now, no festival, but still three team nights, which started out Tuesday, and it ends tonight with this last evening. Because of the same reasons concerning Corona and the regulations, we've decided to only stream these nights online. So without a live audience and just a few guests and a few speakers. And good to say, as you can already hear, and maybe you were here yesterday or the day before, all three evenings are in English. Let me first introduce myself shortly. My name is Anja Toonstra. I'm a comedian, a musician, and a moderator. And tonight I'll be your host to lead you through this whole evening. These three team nights are organized and presented by the Media Art Festival in collaboration with the Rug Campus Friesland, the Hanse University College in Groningen, and ARC North. And the idea of these evenings is to have three interwoven online events full of exploration, discussion, and artistic inspiration. The central main theme of these nights is here and now, and every evening has its own sub-theme which will be explored and unraveled by our guest researchers who are sitting next to me. Tuesday, we zoomed in on the subject of culturenomics, the appreciation of culture and the economic value of the cultural sector as a whole. Yesterday, we discussed the act and the force of not knowing, a matching theme in these wobbly times of crisis, I'd say. And tonight, the title of tonight is People of All Species, Also Humans. And this last evening, we'll talk about our human relationship with nature and how art reflects on that relationship. Because in the past decennia, still more scientific proof appeared that our, especially our Western assumptions about nature are maybe rather flawed, and in arts, particularly in the media art, you can see that also artists question these conceptions of nature and our relationship with our earth. Often, these artists, they operate somewhere on the border of science and art, trying to give new insights to all of us about our natural environment, and they try to encourage us to rethink who we are, we humans as species, and to reconsider our ways of being on and with this planet. These artists' work, they can maybe also help us to oppose our dominant visions on the other living beings, and maybe even more important, art dares to imagine a future that gives alternatives for the unstable systems we created through time. So this theme night is all about art, about humans, and about the earth. And for that, we invited three guests who are sitting here to, from their own perspective and their own work, elaborate on this. Our first speaker is Dr. Jan van Boeckel from the Professorship Art and Sustainability from Academie Minerva in Groningen. The second speaker is Paula Nishijima. And next to Paula is Theun, and they are both visual artists and researchers. Welcome to the three of you. All three of you, you will give a lecture from about 25 minutes, and afterwards, after the three lectures, we'll discuss together some more about everything. But also you at home, we invite you to take part in the discussion afterwards. So feel free to ask your questions and place your remarks in the online chat, and we'll try to take them with us in our discussion at the end. And one more thing before we really begin. If you want to donate to the Media Art Festival, that's very possible and very welcome too. You can find the link underneath the online chat in which these donations can be made, and we warmly encourage you to do so. But for now, let's begin. Jan van Boeckel, I invite you to go to the lecture. And in the meanwhile, I'll introduce you. Jan van Boeckel, Dr. Jan van Boeckel, from the Professorship Art and Sustainability at Academie Minerva Groningen. He started his career as a cultural anthropologist, but he increasingly focused on his own artistic practice and on art education. Now he works at the Hanse Minerva Academy at Groningen. He researches there how art can help us face the great challenges of our time, which the ecological crisis is most pressing, maybe. Ladies and gentlemen, I give the word to Jan van Boeckel.
Thank you, Anne-Jan. Yes, my presentation is called The Earth Breathes Us, and I'll dwell a bit on what I mean with this. That is such maybe starting with a short film. This quote is not from me, it is from Herman de Vries, the Dutch artist who works a lot with natural materials, found objects in nature. At one point he said, "When I breathe, nature enters my lungs. Sometimes I have the feeling that I am not breathing, but the outside world is breathing me, because I'm obliged to breathe." So maybe to illustrate what this could mean, I would like to show you an excerpt of some shots that were made by my son, who is a teacher in Greenland at the moment. And this he shot a few weeks ago, and I thought it was very fitting for the theme that I will touch upon this evening. Meditative film, you might say, slow movement of the sea, the gentle movement, the ice is sort of slowing down the movement of the water. But here's another one. It's in the sky, the starlings moving in this murmuration, and it is this part time of the year when we see these movements in the sky. We might be lucky to experience them and be inspired by something that is larger than ourselves, something that is more encompassing than just our body, that maybe at some point we feel some kind of connection to a larger whole. And I know that people here in the audience, people over there, but also maybe some of you at home may have gotten a clay ball. This clay ball is under your chair or maybe right in front of you. And I would like to ask you during my presentation not to make notes necessarily with a pen and paper, but to make notes in clay, to use the clay to express what kind of impressions you get from my presentation, how you make sense of it, how it touches you or not touches you, so that the clay becomes your way of engaging with it. And for the rest, I'll just keep on giving my presentation. So maybe afterwards we can take a look at this. One more short film about this larger than human world. From a film we made with a group a few years ago about how art can catch a rabbit. So this idea of that we are part of a larger whole is maybe expressed by many different indigenous peoples, this idea that the earth doesn't belong to us, we belong to the earth. There's sort of a turning around of positions. And a scientist, philosopher, biologist, psychologist who tried to express this thought in his thinking is Gregory Bateson, who came up with this idea of an ecology of mind. And I'll try to put very simply what he possibly meant with this idea of an ecology of mind. From his own words, he talks about the experience of a lumberjack cutting down a tree and the relationship between this man and the tree. So Bateson then says, each stroke of the axe is modified or corrected according to the shape of the cut face of the tree left by the previous stroke. The self-corrective, that is mental process, is brought about by a total system, tree, eyes, brain, muscles, axe, stroke, tree, and it is this total system that has the characteristics of immanent mind. Put in other words, the mind is not limited to our brain, to our head, it's the whole system which the tree is part, the axe is part, the muscles are part. So, and Bateson says this is maybe a more correct way of looking at what a mind is. D.H. Lawrence, the writer, spent part of his life in Taos, New Mexico, and he reflected a lot upon the religions, the beliefs of the Pueblo Indians, and he wrote in this essay, New Mexico, "It was a vast old religion, greater than anything we know, more starkly and nakedly religious. It's not the pantheism we are accustomed to, which expresses itself as God is everywhere, God is everything. In the oldest religion, everything was alive, not supernaturally, but naturally alive. There were only deeper and deeper streams of life, vibrations of life more and more vast. The whole life effort of man was to get his life into contact with the elemental life of cosmos, mountain life, cloud life, thunder life, air life, earth life, sun life, to come into immediate contact and so derive energy, power, and a dark sort of joy. This effort into sheer naked contact without the intermediary or mediator is the root meaning of religion," he said. So how come that this very basic way of relating to the more than human world, the non-humans, nature, as we call it, has gone so much to a distance? And here I look at the views of John Berger, who wrote this book of Looking on at Animals. He is particularly fascinated by what happens when we visit a zoo and the distance that we have there. This is from another film we made in the 80s, it's called The Earth is Crying.
Als we de noodkreet van het bos niet meer horen, zijn we zelf dood. Hier kun je goed zien hoe we gewend zijn de natuur te bekijken. Van achter het hek kunnen we de eenzame buffel praktisch aanraken, zo dichtbij is hij. Maar de afstand tussen ons en het gekooide dier laat zich niet alleen in meters uitdrukken. Verschanst achter tralies staan we los, apart, gescheiden van de dieren en de rest van de natuur.
Zwaaien hun mes zelfs met een afgetrokken staartje in het rond. Die manier van doen houden ze vol in de dierentuin. Nijlpaarden houden verder onderling contact door middel van geluiden.
They see no life. When they look, they see only objects. The world is a dead thing for them. The trees and rivers are not alive. The mountains and stones are not alive. The deer and bear are objects.
So it is this objectivation, this putting at a distance, being separated, that fascinated John Berger. And there's a film made on John Berger called Parting Shots of Animals in the 1980s, in which he says, we animals are disappearing. It's from the viewpoint of the animals. We have made a film not so much about us, the animals, but about you, the people. And here's a small part of this film, which was part of another film. Part of the film, The Caesars and Quincy.
We animals are disappearing. We have made a film. Not so much of what remains of us, the animals, but of you, the people. Make no mistake, we are not victims. We are emigrants. We are going back into the ark.
Man becomes aware of himself, returning the look. The animal scrutinizes him across a narrow abyss of non-comprehension. This is why the man can surprise the animal. Yet the animal, even if domesticated, can also surprise the man.
So what fascinates Berger is what kind of look do we have when we look at animals behind fences, in cages, behind the glass. And then he makes this statement about the zoo. He says, the zoo cannot but disappoint. The public purpose of zoos is to offer visitors the opportunity of looking at animals. Yet, nowhere in a zoo can a stranger encounter the look of the animal. At the most, the animal's gaze flickers and passes on. They look sideways. They look blindly beyond. They scan mechanically. They've been immunized to encounter because nothing can anymore occupy a central place in their attention. So something very basically has disappeared from these caged animals. And I think maybe the most dramatic way of depicting our relationship to the other, the non-human, is from this 1910 film of a fly that is glued on the top of a match and seen as a kind of little acrobat. So torture being made as fun or curiosity. We thought that maybe this is beyond us, that this is long ago. More recently is the Tamagotchi from the 1990s. This is like a virtual reality pet that children can look after some kind of virtual being. When it needs food, it will make a sound, or when it needs to go to the toilet. So you can pretend that you're taking care of a non-human being, but it is totally in the virtual domain. And there's an artwork by Matt Kenyon called the Tardigotchi. A tardigrade is a common microorganism measuring half a millimeter in length. So you see the image there on the screen. A Tardigotchi is an artwork featuring two pets, a living organism and an alive avatar. In one half of the brass sphere is the alive avatar depicted on a LED screen, and in the other half is a tardigrade which lives within a prepared slide. This portable sphere playfully references the famous Tamagotchi toy from the 1990s. What's interesting about this toy is how it encourages pet owner behavior. Does simple interaction engender emotional attachment? Can feelings of affection blossom? Does biological life make a difference? So this is this artwork, where you have both a live form and a virtual form together.
This is a Tardigotchi. The Tardigotchi is an object of the exotic variety. It is an animal, a game, a pet, an interface, a character, a feeder, a home to a living organism. This is Stephen, the water bear. He is a tardigrade, an amazingly versatile creature. Look how he travels, without a sense of direction, in a world without distances. He is a loner, all by himself in a big orb. This is Gotchi. He is a pixelated character. He is Stephen. He likes sunbathing. He likes his environment. Biological life and digital life. Real, virtual. Virtual, real.
So I would suggest that this, even in artwork, it's still this objectivation, this manipulation of a life form, even as small as a tardigrade, in this artwork. not necessarily feeling that someone is connected or has some kind of active relationship, respectful relationship with another human, another living being. So now I switch to another point of view of how can we become more in contact, become more entangled with the non-human, the more than human world. And here I look at the work of David Abram, who says that some people in indigenous cultures are maybe a bit too transparent, too porous, that they absorb all kind of information from the larger world, and that puts them in a hard position among humans because they are a bit shy, a bit withdrawn, but that makes them excellent people to negotiate with the more than human, and often these people then become the shamans, the people who are in this position to communicate with the non-human beings. One artist who tried to do this in his work, to find ways to develop this shamanic capacity to communicate with the non-human, is Josef Beuys. Here in his How to Show Images to a Dead Hare, one of his acts in the 60s. And here his project in I Like America, America Likes Us, where he was for 3 days in a cage together with a coyote. He flew to New York and went straight to the studio and was spent there these 3 days, and then flew straight back. Here you see some excerpts of this action or performance or encounter. And for him, this coyote was representative of the indigenous peoples, of the non-European elements in the new continent. And his act, he sought for himself a shamanic act to sort of make good or to rework our broken relationship with the natural world. And I think these images are quite well known. And in the course of the 3 days, they developed a closer and closer relationship. And when at last he embraced the coyote and left again. Somebody who tried this too, maybe not as a shaman, but maybe as a person deeply interested in other wild creatures, is Timothy Treadwell, who's the main character in this documentary of Werner Herzog. And unfortunately, he moved so much into the world of the non-human, of the grizzly bears, he and his girlfriend eventually were killed by the bear. Green.
Behind me is Ed and Rowdy, members of an up-and-coming sub-adult gang. They're challenging everything, including me. Goes with the territory. If I show weakness, if I retreat, I may be hurt, I may be killed. I must hold my own if I'm going to stay within this land. For once there is weakness, they will exploit it, they will take me out, they will decapitate me, they will chop me into bits and pieces. I'm dead.
So you see that he came to 8 summers in this area in Alaska with the bears, and also with other creatures living there, such as the fox, and became more and more at ease, but also maybe crossed a line that he became in a way too close.
With Mr. Chocolate and Spirit, the fox, and here come some of her pops, yay! Some of her pops.
He was filming himself while being in this area.
Hi.
And these film recordings remained afterwards and were compiled to this documentary by Werner Herzog.
You know, it's on loan and they came in and took it. Mm-hmm.
And how do you see Timothy Treadwell's story?
I see it as something that's both, it's tragic because yeah, he died, and his girlfriend died because, you know, he tried to be a bear. He tried to act like a bear, and for us on the island, you don't do that. You don't invade on their territory. When you're in their territory, you know you're there, and when you're nearby, you make sure that they know you're around. You know, for him to act like a bear the way he did would be, I don't know, to me it was the ultimate of disrespecting the bear and what the bear represents.
But he tried.
So you might say that Timothy Treadwell, different maybe from Josef Beuys, went across the line, that a line that indigenous peoples would respect, But you might also say that Boyce did his performance in a cage situation with an animal that was locked up. Arne Naess, the philosopher who coined the term deep ecology, said that he was trying to develop a closer relationship with the non-living world, and he would call this the wide identification, that you see part of yourself in the other. And he gave two examples of this. One is of this dam, this is the dam in the Alta River in northern Norway. And he met a Sami person, an indigenous person, who said, if you're going to make this dam, the dam is there now, into this river, then I cannot cross the river anymore with my reindeer. And that would be like cutting off my arm, because the river is as much part of me as is this river. So he identified with a landscape, with a living river, as seeing it as part of his body, as part of his being. Arne Naess had a similar experience when he was up in his mountain cabin doing some kind of research with liquids, and then at some point there was a lemming on his table, a small rodent. And from the fur of this lemming, there was a flea jumping into the liquid that he was studying under the microscope. And then under the microscope, he was seeing how this flea was dying, the contractions of its six limbs. And he couldn't help it. He could just be witness to its suffering. And he couldn't help but identifying with something that was other than him, but yet felt very similar. And he calls this wide identification. And through that, he says, by building this wide identification, you build the ecological self. Somebody who reflected on this is David Abram.
Arne's sense of identification, or wider identification with... Arne's...
I'll skip this part. What David says in this interview that I did with him about this quote of Arne, that this idea of wider identification... that if you identify too fully, if you make yourself completely identical to a non-human being or a non-human landscape, then you also lose the tension, the eros, the pulsing of life through the difference also disappears. So that he partly disagrees here with Arne that we should pursue a too deep wide identification, which we maybe see in this film that is very popular at the moment, My Octopus Teacher, where a man is in this kelp forest underwater in South Africa, the day when it all and develops this very deep relationship with a non-human really being, in this strange case an octopus, with its own intelligence.
A lot of people say an octopus is like an alien. But the strange thing is, as you get closer to them, you realize that you're very similar in a lot of ways.
It's part of the trailer of this film. And in this trailer, the filmmaker Craig Foster says at some point, what she taught me, the octopus, was that you are part of this place, not as a visitor. And that's a huge difference. That, so not being a visitor, but really feeling to be that one is a part, maybe not completely identifying. And David Abram, in this same interview, also makes the same point. That is, if I feel like I'm part of the landscape, then I can so easily fall in love with other parts. I can also acknowledge that when I say I here, I am speaking of my smaller self, this body, which is part of this larger flesh. So, I think what I come back to, as I've started, if you recall, the first images of the eyes moving in the water, is that this meeting of other human beings, be it an octopus, be it a bear, be it a coyote, can give us maybe some appreciation of this idea of that the soul is not in us, but we are in soul. It's like a turning inside out, that we don't foreground ourselves as being in the center, but our soul is basically, our mind is basically part of something larger, more encompassing than ourselves. Which I once recorded 10 years ago at this 1,000-year oak, old oak in southern Norway. It's suddenly, after a very cold night, came alive to me. So maybe in some profound sense, this idea of the earth is breathing us, this idea of Herman de Vries. Those of you who made a clay work, or maybe the people also here, if you would like to maybe, if you came so far, to put it on the table, that we can take a look at it. People sitting here. Well, maybe we start with you. How was it for you to do this, to make this work while you were listening to my words?
I think maybe in the beginning I was kind of expanding like the clay and just experimenting, etc. And in a certain point then I realized it became more unstable, and then I started like to reconnect what I had expanded earlier. So yeah, it's a nice way to take notes. I think in a way it has to do with the process. I think of taking notes, like expanding, and then you have kind of more a chaos, and then you start like to reconnect the information.
And for you?
You were sort of speaking about the earth, and then we had this globe of clay, and it was sort of a grounding experience where you suddenly it's different than taking notes on a piece of paper.
Well, thank you.
Thank you, Jan van Boeckel.
Jan, let's start with the clay balls and the why of the clay balls. What can the clay balls bring to the listener instead of writing down or just pay attention to your lecture?
Yeah, I think it opens up many different dimensions, but maybe to me one of the most obvious is that if people attend to a lecture, like in non-COVID times, people sit in an audience room with their notebooks to write something down, then you are in sort of student mode, and you perform the kind of work that you are supposed to do when you're sitting in a lecture hall. If you suddenly find a ball of clay under your chair and you're asked to make notes in the clay, hopefully that will access some other part of your being, of paying attention. You suddenly engage more bodily, less verbally, if you will, and maybe through that heightened attention of other points of entry of engaging with what's going on, maybe your whole attention to the subject also shifts, that you're not just recording, but you're recording in clay, but also giving expression to something. At least that's my hope, that it does this.
Yeah, you say it's hope. Is it scientifically proven, or is it just still hope?
It's a tough one, but they say they've done these studies that if people make drawings of lectures, often that through the drawing, that if they later ask these people to recall what was being shared, that the recollections of people making notes through drawing are often more accurate than through writing. Maybe because the whole imaginative capacity is also engaged, not only the verbal, the more strict mode of writing.
Your whole lecture was about connecting as a human being, connecting with a larger whole, with nature, with the non-human. That suggests we once lost this connection. Mm-hmm. Where and when did we lose this connection with nature?
Yeah, I think that it's very hard there to pinpoint exact moments. I think it's by like different shocks, different moments of upheaval in time. But maybe one point that's often referred to that was around the 7th century, when people, at least in the Western European world, before, it was a practice that if you would cut down a tree, you would ask the guardian spirit, the genius Loki, if it was appropriate, if you had permission to cut down this tree. And then with the rise of Christianity and the whole modern development, suddenly it was no longer necessary to ask any spirit or spirit of the place if it was appropriate or not to cut the tree. You could just do it for economic purposes. And I think these kind of instances, because if you don't have to ask for permission of the other living being, And now we might say this is all imaginative, this mm-hmm. is all in your mind. But if you don't no longer have this taboo that it is somehow not appropriate to do this, then it is much more easily, you're not bothered by your conscience when doing it. But it's just one instant. It's like the whole process of how we lost touch of nature is through many centuries and it differed at different places.
But this whole tendency, this wish to immerse with nature, of this make this deeper connection with nature, it's a very human need, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
You don't see it happening with other animals, or do we? Can you see it with other animals too?
Yeah, I think this was where what John Berger was getting at, that the fact that you see this emptiness in a caged animal in a zoo, that it cannot doesn't engage with you, but has this dull view in the mind. I think another way to put this is that maybe that they are missing something basically, the free roaming possibilities of nature, and that one might maybe anthropomorphize or see it from a totally anthropocentric point of view. If you would say, well, they are longing for nature, that's what we read in them. But I think animals who are not in encaged are generally more free or more energetic, more alive, and therefore also less inclined maybe to seek contact. They're in their own world and very different from animals that are sort of in only one type of space, organized space, where the humans are steering what's happening.
Thank you very much, Jan. I invite you to go take the stage, go to the lecture. Paula Nishijima. Paula is a visual artist whose research-based practice includes intersections with life science, technology, and participatory social practice, exploring individual and collective motivation either through happenings or longer processes of interaction. Her production materializes into different digital media such as video, web applications, and photography. It sounds very beautiful. Paula received a Master in Arts and Culture from the Leiden University and also holds a bachelor degree in visual arts. Ladies and gentlemen, Paula Nishijima.
Thank you. Thank you. So today I'm going to present a work that will be featured in the Media Art Festival. The title is Game of Swarms. I would like to propose before the presentation a sort of meditation, a guided experience, because my work tends to be kind of theoretical. So I want us to think about this kind of very obvious nature of people of all species, which are people embodied. So we are all embodied. So we'll just ask to reduce a little bit the light, and you all can participate, also who is watching us right now. I just ask you like to make yourself comfortable in your seat. Close your eyes. Just let your hands rest on your lap. Start to be aware of your body. And take a deep breathing. And out. Now, pay attention to what is happening. Feel the air rushing into your lungs. Feel your chest as it expands. This is possible because your diaphragm and your muscles between the ribs work together. Remember that before the air can reach your lungs, to make room for the air to come in, a network of neurons has worked to send a message to make your diaphragm and the muscles to contract, expanding your lungs, reducing the internal pressure and rushing the air into them. When you breathe again, focus on your throat as it opens, allowing the air flow coming to your body. Feel the muscles working again to compress your chest. Feel the air being pushed out from your lungs, through your nose, and through your mouth. The earth feels you when you breathe in. When you breathe out, you feel the earth. You have need of oxygen. Oxygen has need of you to hitch a ride onto your blood cells and reach the tissues throughout your body. How oxygen and hemoglobin hold onto each other in their own special way makes this possible. Remember that hemoglobin is a protein that you make out of the iron that you ingest. You ingest from the road, from the earth, all around you. It helps the oxygen reach out and touch all the parts of your body, your kidneys, your heart, your stomach, your gut, and all the microorganisms there. Feel the multitude of living species inside your bowels. People of many species, not only human, also helping you to breathe. And come back to your breathing. Try to imagine how the connections between your organs, your cells, molecules, and the other microorganisms work together. All this you and your body are orchestrating with every breath. Although you don't quite know how, although you don't really feel in charge of it all. Now, slowly you can open your eyes, maybe take a breath in and out, take a bit of a stretch. Come back to this super organism who has been sitting here whole, being its whole self, a swarm of many, many things that is you and not only you, always at the same time. So, I wanted to start with this exercise because breathing is usually a kind of straightforward action. Like we don't have to think to breathe. And then we tend to forget that behind this very basic action for life, there is a very complex system behind and many, many other systems. And that our body is actually a system within a broader system. And then when you breathe in, you are breathing the world, you are breathing the environment, you are breathing. So it's the environment is constantly coming inside you and being part of you. So I really like the first presentation. I think I remember there was a citation about also the breathing. And it has to do with this idea that we breathe in, but also the earth is breathing us, in a way. So this is the introduction for the Game of Swarms. Okay. I'm going to jump into the first piece. So just to explain, Game of Swarms is a series of works. The idea is that each work kind of inspires the next. So it's an interaction, a sequence of interaction of works. The first piece is a video animation, and it's more about a kind of aesthetical investigation of swarms and networks. So my research is on living systems and living networks, also artificial ones, but today I'm going to focus on the swarm framework. I am interested in the self-organized and the collective behavior of swarms in nature. So, for instance, ants, bees that are social insects, and also some kinds of slime molds that behave in a way as a kind of swarm. So the video, the title of the video is based on this idea of tentacularity of Donna Haraway. And I really like this, this sentence of life lived along lines and not at points, not in spheres. So this is the main subject. And when I was taking my notes with the clay, I'd like to say that I was also wondering about like the sphere. He said also about it, like the globe, this idea of the sphere, the point, and how we actually represent some kind of individual through this format. So here you can see the network topologies, but these are representations of a network as we usually see them. And what I try like to question in this video is this representation of the individuals as nodes and as spheres, as points, and the connections as straight lines. But a connection is not just a straight line, right? And so aesthetics for me is so much about how we represent the world where we live, how we see the world, and how we think that the world is. So by doing this representation of networks as nodes and connections as straight lines, we are kind of reducing the whole complexity that there is behind the systems and all these connections that create our life phenomena. So I put here challenging the spheres. My narrative, I created a kind of narrative in which we depart from the globe, from the sphere, from the individual as a bounded individual, and expressing this idea that we are autonomous, that we can actually, we are divided, we can live disconnected from the world or nature. So here I brought some frames, and the idea is that this individual connects to other and start like to cohabitate, to live together with them. I have here, a video I'm gonna play. Okay. So this is a part of the video when they start to connect, and I was wondering what is the imagery, what is the body of an individual after all, because it's not just the sphere. So the idea is that it can actually evolve to this life lived along lines through the connections, and not focused on the role of one individual, one role, one leader, etc. So I'm going to speak a little bit about the research and about the Game of Swarm as a project, because I don't do this alone. It's always a collaborative project. So in a way, it's a kind of meta project because it's about swarms. One of the key points about the swarm is because they work collaboratively. So in a swarm, you don't have like a leader, you don't have a central control. Even if we speak about the queen ant or the queen bee, this is our human language about them, because the role that they are playing is not a role of a leader. They are not ruling the nest or the hive. I really like this image of the ants, and maybe you can see better here what I'm trying like to question about the aesthetics of a body or about an individual, because here they are forming these ants together in a cooperative way. So in a way, it is already a superorganism, and a superorganism is already a body as well. So my research was focused on social insects, and also this is the slimy mold that I mentioned before. It's called also the blob. So the great thing about it, it has no brain, so it has no central control, but it's known because it's a very kind of smart living being. Even if it's just, it's neither a plant nor a fungi, it's a very kind of archaic living being. But it manifests a kind of collective intelligence in a way. So the Game of Swarms was a project created also to raise questions and try like to reimagine some answers, but yes, reimagine some stories to answer these questions, like how we are tackling global issues, for instance. And here I want to touch the matter about the agency, because we have today this globalized world, and we know what is happening on the other side of the world. So, and sometimes we have this crisis about the agency, like what can I do for such a big problem, such a global problem? And I think the swarm helps like to inspire us in a way to understand that each one has equal agency, and what you do locally, I mean, in your local interaction, your local action can have a global effect. This is a view of the exhibition where I presented the Game of Swarms, so just to see the I put it here mostly to show also the idea about the scale. So the video animation, as you saw, it's a little bit like kind of abstract, and it seems like we are talking about microorganisms, but it was presented in a greater scale, so there is this play with the scale. This is the second piece of the Game of Swarms, which is, I call it a more performative work. So I held some sessions of workshop with a prototype of the Game of Swarms. So the prototype, you can see here, is basically the representation of the networks with nodes and connections. And there is the one node that is kind of special node, which is the master node, and representing this idea about the individual, about a centralization of agency or power that we can locate within our society. And so I invited the people like to reflect about it, about we humans, we have like centralization of powers, we have the notion of the individual autonomous and self-determined, the disconnected from the rest. So how can we reimagine a new narrative for that? How can we foster more collaborative behavior between humans, as we have a so competitive kind of frame? We grew up in this more competitive frame, like the old saw of the survival of the fittest. So the audience and also the collaborators, they could like play with this prototype, and the idea, the goal, was to co-create the rules. So basically, they were making together the game. And I like this idea that Game of Swarms is not here like to break the rules, but to co-create them. I think it's different. And yeah, I like to play with it, with this notion as well. And also this prototype was made to be played by other people in different places as well. So Game of Swarms could be a kind of device, a communication device that you can just walk your talk and then play together and elaborate on new rules, new protocols to relate to each other. Because in the end, the network is about relationships. And now I'm kind of baking a new sequence for this work. I'm going to use these co-created rules by the audience to test, to make a kind of experiment and see how resilient or robust could be a network co-created by humans. Okay, thank you.
Paula, it was a very interesting story, and we talked about it before, and sometimes for me it was quite mind-boggling, but because it's interesting, but it's also quite abstract and quite theoretical. But you, when talking about the swarm, you proposed the swarm idea, this model of the swarm as a framework to discuss how we could tackle world problems like COVID-19, the environmental crisis, or politics in general.
Yeah.
Could you explain a little bit more of in what way this whole framework of the swarm could be used in that?
Yeah, I think to start maybe this question about see ourselves not as individuals, autonomous, disconnected, but as a swarm. So what I try to bring with that meditation is also this notion that we are a swarm, like we function as a swarm. And if you are more conscious about it, you can be more inspired to behave in a similar way, meaning collaborative behavior among us is something, yeah, it's a value, but sometimes we tend to be more individualistic in a way. So like, I think this notion is a key notion to be changed or to be, we have to adapt.
So maybe it's about be more conscious of the force of collaboration.
Yes, yes.
That but also the force of your individual force.
Yeah, yeah. They coexist in a way, like this notion of the individual. This is all about a way of thinking. So the notion of the individual exists together with the collaboration.
Because when you look at a swarm, as you explained the swarm, in the swarm there is no leader.
Yeah.
But we humans, we are very used to follow leaders, and especially in tackling worldwide problems, my human reflex would be we need leaders.
Yes. Yeah, the project is not about like make a comparison between social insects and humans. So, but it's more about two questions. So maybe what kind of leader is better for our situation right now? Do you need more totalitarian and more authoritarian kinds of leaders, or we need a more self-organized, a more organic way of leading, for instance? So it's not, yeah, like I said, it's not to break the rules, but maybe to create new rules and new, more sustainable and more ethical rules to live in the times that we live.
Thank you, Paula Nishijima. Thank you for your story. We go to our last guest, third and last guest, Theun Karelse. I invite you to go to the lecture. Theun Karelse, he studied fine arts at the Sandberg Institute in Amsterdam before joining FOAM, which is a transdisciplinary laboratory at the interstitch of art, science, nature, and everyday life. His interest in experimental practice explores edges between art, environment, technology, and archaeology. And lately, he's been creating research programs that consist of fieldwork as a means of critical reflection. And I think that is what he's going to talk about. Ladies and gentlemen, Theun Karelse.
Good evening, people of all species. That's an introduction, and there's always sort of a build-up in it, which I guess, you know, I've written it myself, but you do this in retrospect. So also in my work, the things I will be talking about is in retrospect. And usually when I'm working, I have a hunch, I have some feeling. But in the beginning, I'm not really sure where I'm heading towards. And by the end of the project, I start to know what I was working on. And the title of today, the theme of people of all species, made me think of friends that I visit, which I've visited for many years. You see here the hands of Purvi. Purvi is one of the gardeners that work in India, in a place where I go often. And this is Shruti. What they work on, it's a group of people who live in India. They live in what's remaining of the rainforest, which are just really small pockets of rainforest, because most of it is now coffee and tea plantations. And the images you're seeing, this area used to also be tea plantations, maybe 40 years ago. And then there was one person who saw a particular plant, an orchid. And orchids live in this area of the world, they live in trees. They are epiphytic, so they live on top of a tree. And this person wondered, how can a plant live if its roots are not in the ground? And from that question, he started to look at, okay, how do they live? And Soon it became apparent to him that they were highly threatened and endangered. So somehow a connection had formed between him and these orchids, and from those one species of plants, the whole thing snowballed. And in 40 years' time, in an area that used to be coffee plantations and tea plantations, there's now rainforest. Rainforest which has been gardened back into life. And with the plants come all kinds of creatures. You see here a caterpillar, but the biodiversity is just through the roof, because all these creatures that live in this range of mountains, they only have pockets where they can find the plants they need or the habitat they need, so it's buzzing there. Last year I went there and I brought a camera, and there's never really a plan when we go to visit, so we just go visit because we're because I'm interested. And because I had the camera, I said, are there maybe old photographs of way back? And so on the left you see one of the earliest photographs of a part of their area, and next with the picture that we try to make from the same position as it is now. So you see sort of a kind of cauliflower shape blooming out of these hills. A lot of the people that live there are indigenous people. So this is Saji. Saji is from the Pania tribe, and they've been there probably the very first waves of people that spread out of Africa, went to Papua New Guinea, went to Australia, the Aboriginals, but also these Pania. So we think they've been there for 10,000 of years, but nobody really knows because there's no written history. But walking into a piece of forest with one of them is, as a European, is quite intimidating because, you know, I have to walk sort of putting my feet where they've put their feet. And meanwhile, they can do the same thing, but they can look there and spot a bird. They can listen to something that's moving there, and they can smell a type of deer that's over there. And it's all happening, you know, it's sort of the person is completely there. It's all external. And Saji says that when Pania people get depressed and they feel really bad, you just walk into the forest and you forget everything because, in a way, you're outside of yourself. I'm inspired to go there, you can see. But this forest is also intimidating. Where I grew up here in Western Europe, nature is something you can watch and you can contemplate, and you can just sit in a park bench and really sort of let your mind go. But when you're in a place with so much life, there's no sort of privacy. There's when you just stop somewhere and you think, what the hell, is that a bird? Is that, what is that? And in the meantime, something has gone to your foot and is starting to eat you. So everything is sort of in a dialogue, and it's pretty intimidating. And it made me realize after many years that I'd never really experienced life at full volume, let's say, with the volume button completely up. And that is kind of, it shocked me, because how many people in the world still have access? You know, we're on the only planet that we know of with life. And then most of us may never really experience what it is to be, you know, fully there. So these are friends, and they are inspiring, and we like to go there, but I only know them, this is a sort of behind the scenes shot, I only know them because these two women are friends. Marianne, on the left, is from Holland, and she's been friends with Vali, on the right, for 40 years. And when we arrive in India, they make the plan. So there's no possibility to have your own private research projects. You just follow the swarm. And it's a dialogue between, okay, our niece from that village is taking a car to that village, so that would be a good moment for you to travel there, and then maybe you can also visit the people there. So, you know, you're sort of in this immersive thing also culturally. I like to work in the field, as it's called, and as I mentioned before, this is more in retrospect. It was never sort of a strategy, but I noticed already in art school that working on my own, so I was good at drawing, but when a drawing is finished, what do? You know, you can then you have to ask people to come and look at it, or not a lot seemed to happen after the drawing was finished. I much rather worked in groups of people where you explore some subject together. And I started to do that more and more in spaces that are not someone's private area. So you start working in landscapes. And what I found is that what works well over the last few years is that when you have a research question and it sort of resonates with other people, that's how groups form, and that's how sort of... And Machine Wilderness was one of those programs. You see here we are for a few weeks in Finland, and in the back of the picture is Ian Ingram, who was part of the team that I assembled. He's sort of going after this reindeer, trying to see what it's doing. Ian builds machines that try to communicate with wild animals. And this machine we tested in the field. So there's sort of an idea of what you want to do. And then there's the actual place. And that's why I like doing field work in a particular place, because things are always more complex than you think. And in this case, the idea was that crows communicate not just with sound, but also with gestures, and they make gestures with their beak along a branch or something else. That's what this machine can do. So we think that a crow, when it does this, is sort of buying time. It's thinking about something in the way that we use as a way to sort of have a moment for yourself to figure out, okay, what am I doing? Where am I? Ian thought that's probably a good way to start a conversation with a crow, that our machine can also say, I don't know. The hard part is, already making the robot is hard, because it can recognize crows and it can sort of do its dance autonomously. But when you're there, the hard part is, how do you connect to crows that are not used to people around? So they're extremely shy. And then, you know, you need local experience. So Antti Tenets was also part of the team. He's Finnish. He is sort of breathing snow, and his arms are stone, and his legs are rivers. He's really part naturalist and part artist. And he leads many expeditions for science or art. So with... What I've noticed is that when you work in a specific area, you need somebody who knows it intimately, who knows it not from not just from a sort of intellectual perspective, but from a lived experience. And Antti could really help us find these how to connect with those crows and not just, you know, crows. So in a way, these programs are aimed at radical exposure of the people who are in it. And I think what I noticed is that it's you tend to think and act differently in your studio or amongst other beings. You get into different conversations, you get different things happen, and you, it's like you you bring in the bowl of clay. It adds complexity, it adds dimensions and freedoms of engaging that are not there in a conference or in a two-hour workshop. And this is not just true for humans, but we also brought machines and showed them the landscape. And we set up this little AI, just Google Inception, and showed it the landscape. And what it saw was snowmobiles, and there were no snowmobiles in the image or in where we were looking at. But it's, in a way, it sort of saw the habitat of snowmobiles. But so you start to wonder, what is, if these machines are starting to have a perception of landscape coming from autonomous cars, ecology is starting to use more and more these kinds of, but also precision farming. A lot of the models, a lot of the material that these machines are trained on is, you know, it's selected by humans. And just by this machine telling us, when we showed it an Arctic environment, it said snowmobiles. It didn't say snow, it didn't say trees, it didn't say lichen or stones. No, it just said snowmobile. It showed that maybe the perception of landscape is commodified already for these machines. So we made that became sort of the second fieldwork program, which was looking into the perception of machines about the environment and where is it sort of complementing our human perception, where is it sort of just taking over our blind spots. And for this, you know, that was also done in fieldwork, and I tried to make these groups more and more diverse. So in this case, not just multidisciplinary. We went to Terschelling. This is Terschelling, and Jan, who is in the picture, was born there, so he's sort of the local. And then Jeroen is the person who knows everything about the geology and the biology of the place. But there's also, and they're sort of in their late 60s, there were people of all ages, and then the youngest participant was Jackson at the bottom of the picture. He's six. And we started a week of research, and Jackson had already sort of figured out the whole thing after 2 hours. He just drew everything for us, and he said, okay, this is how it works, guys. But so the dynamic between sort of academic elderly gentlemen quoting big philosophers and then some more outgoing guys who really like just and girls who just like, you know, let's run, let's let's fly a drone, let's do some let's spot some strange plants. And then to have a little boy there, it really changed the whole dynamic. We had to improvise a little bit with our working space. So here we're in the Stay Okay, in the recreation room, trying to build models of how AIs would relate to landscapes in general, just ways of prototyping it. And So what I've come across is that working from not knowing is really enriching. So there's the role of the expert, but there's also the role of the person who is new and who sees things for the first time. And I'm strengthened in this by research done by Kenneth Stanley, who does research on how artificial intelligence, how neural networks learn. Classic neural networks are trained in a specific task. So you have the classic test is to have artificial intelligence go through a maze and try to find the exit. And a really good one, you give it 40 tries and it will find the exit maybe 6-7 times. Kenneth Stanley didn't optimize his neural network to find any exit. He optimized it to find novelty. So he gave his neural network the ability to explore and find new dimensions of exploration. So a classic neural network is successful in maybe 6 or 7 cases. His is, out of 40 tries, it's successful in 39. So I think there's a lot of this type of things in biology, that biological processes and organisms explore, and that gives them a way of finding their way. I was sort of in a residency on a little rubber boat trying to find some beavers that were there. I sort of wanted to be closer, but the only thing that was there was this little rubber boat, so I built a better research vessel with a little tent so you could also see underwater when you close it. I'll skip this, I think. This is recent. In Zeeland, we're sort of doing research looking at the future for sort of multi-species future for Zeeland. You know, the land is going down, the sea is going up. So we did a lot of interviews, and this interview is with Frank Sanderink, who is interested in the bruinvis, a small type of whale. And this is a listening post for bruinvis, which he made. And I was interested in experiencing this feeling of sonar. The bruinvis sort of finds its way through sonar that comes from the front of its head. So I made a little speaker that plays the voice of the animal, and I put it on my head and then just tried it out and see what it feels like. And I was also, the relationship of the Dutch and the sea is sort of quite stagnant. We made dikes and we're sort of not very flexible. So I was also interested in seaweeds. And I made a seaweed suit and tried out how it was quite interesting. sort of to feel the qualities in a way, or the perspective of another being. That's more recent. I think I'll leave it at that. This is just showing that I like working with within other contexts. So I've been working with a friend who is a fruit farmer for maybe 10 years, and in forestry, and in just to sort of dive into other worlds and see how those people relate to reality. And what I noticed is if you work with people or become friends with them for a longer time, they start to tell you things that you won't hear in the first interview. And you get a sense of, I now know how heavy it is to carry a specific plant. I know I know what it means to gather leaves. I know what it means to make a fake forest like this. So that's enough. Thank you.
Thank you. Theun Karelse. Theun, you are clearly very enthusiastic about working in the field.
Yeah.
It brings you a lot
yeah.
as a researcher, as an artist. Are there also downsides to that way of working for
yeah.
you?
Hmm. Yeah, I'm not really an outdoor person. So there's a hurdle, there's sort of a thing you have to get over, but I like the challenge. The challenge makes you sort of step out of yourself a little bit and discover new things about yourself. The hard thing as an artist is maybe that who's the audience?
What do you mean by that?
Because you're if you're working in Finland with a team of maybe with a few people or where who how do you show this? How do you what are the end results? What how do you share this? And that's not so easy. Maybe videos can help, but also sort of in giving shorter 2-day workshops for bigger groups of people works quite well. Also bringing experiments from the field and showing them in a working outside modus next to if a museum has a garden, that's great. But that's a challenge.
Yeah, because you have the experience at that very moment, and as you say, you live life fully at that very moment. But to bring that to the audience, that whole idea.
Yeah, it feels a bit like you have to, like now, you have to be a storyteller in a way to revive it.
It asks something very different from you.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
At the end, you talked a little bit about the freedom and relevance of starting from not knowing.
Yeah.
Exactly the theme we've been discussing yesterday. How hard is that for you as an artist to work from that state of not knowing, or to reach that state of not knowing?
Oh, well, that's quite easy.
Yeah?
Yeah. If your research question is something that's really sort of out there, mm-hmm. If your research question is what happens or how can machines participate in ecosystems in the way that animals do or organisms do, you know, nobody really knows that. That's new for somebody who works in robotics. That's new for a child who's 6 years old. So there's a level playing ground. If you're really sort of pushing it into sort of unknown territory.
So for you, it's not that difficult to reach that state of not knowing?
No, but to be able to engage with people from other fields, mm-hmm. you have to know enough to be able to engage with them. You know, the question has to be relevant for the scientist also,
yeah.
and for the philosopher, or for the singer, or the dancer, or the child. And so you're sort of an intermediate between people. More like that.
So as an artist, for you, it's not that difficult to reach that state of not knowing, but for maybe artists now watching us who have more difficulty with that, do you have a advice how to get there?
Yeah, go to a place you don't know yet. Yeah.
Yeah. As you do.
Yeah.
All the time.
Well, I don't do it all the time. It looks like that from the pictures,
yeah.
but I also have a home.
Luckily enough. Yeah. Thank you, Theun Karelse. Thank you, all the three of you, for your lectures. You listen to each other's lectures. What did you hear in each other's lectures? What stood out? Is there something what inspired you, or you thought it was interesting, would you will take with you in your own work? Someone?
Yeah, I think Jan was giving such an overview, also in time and in sort of breadth, width, that I thought, wow, there's some people here in this. I have to look back at this presentation and look at some of the names. And I know a few of them. I don't know some of the others. That felt really enriching for tonight.
Yeah, so maybe telling what you the last words you said, to maybe to connect with those of this position of not knowing. And to me, I would say it is maybe one of the hardest things to achieve for artists or anybody, because the knowing, I think, is so profoundly in between us and what's there. So already maybe the concept of nature suggests that there is something separate from us, which is nature, and that our lens or our perspective is always so guided as how we compartmentalize the other, the non-human, so that the concepts, our understandings, it's so difficult, I think, to unlearn what we already have in our backpack. I think it was Picasso who said that he spent his whole life trying to appreciate again the way a child appreciates the world. So it's I think, rather hard to be in a fundamental, in a deep unknowing.
Yeah,
and Paula, I also thought with the swarm that how much space there is for the erratic or the exceptional or those forces that deviate, that don't work with the swarm. But so how, if the swarm as a sort of ideal concept is sort of would be guiding, how do we prevent that the collective in a way suffocates the people who cannot adapt or the beings that cannot adapt?
Yes, in a way. I just wanted also to connect what your lecture and what Theun just said. What I think is amazing, like you have to go out to discover about yourself, more things about yourself. And so I think this reconnection with nature, what we are defining as nature here, has to do with it. I mean, we have to reconnect to also redefine us in a way. And to redefine us, we have first to discover many things about ourselves. So I like how all the lectures were also in synchronicity, in a way. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
it's kind of scary how much we are connected. You know, we never really lost the connection to nature, mm-hmm. or to the environment. We just sort of didn't pay much attention to it for quite a while. So maybe emotionally detached, but biologically, it's frightening how, sure. you know, the extended body mm-hmm. it is really. And when that starts to sort of hurt and die, that's, yeah, that's intimidating.
So, but to close off, before we go to the questions from the viewers, we started tonight with the title, People of All Species, Also Humans. If we look back now, do you, the three of you, do you agree on that title, or how do you look at this title?
Well, people is, you know, people is also het volk. That part of it feels a bit
the mob.
Yeah, that feels a bit sort of we the people, and they are something else. You know, that's sort of the insiders and the outsiders, but I don't. It's not aimed at that. It's sort of trying to see other beings, I guess, as fully there as humans are. I think that's what the title tries to suggest.
Someone else?
I really like first this title. I think it has to do with the way how I use the framework of the swarm, so they are using also this framework of people. Mm-hmm. And the last part is very important. People of all species, also humans. So humans here, they are not exceptional in a way. So I think this is the important part about the title. We are trying like to displace this exceptional status that we are giving ourselves, or that we have been giving us.
Jan, do you have a reaction?
Yeah, it reminds me in a way of this idea of Aldo Leopold, this great American conservationist, who said that we are not rulers of the world, of other species, but we are plain citizens of the Earth community. Mm. But I think also in many indigenous peoples, they refer to other species as peoples, the people of the beaver, or the people of the ants. And I wonder if the species word, the species, suggests already the dissecting of putting apart, whereas I think people more foregrounds the idea of community.
Mm-hmm. Thanks to you for now. Irene is standing there with some
Hello.
Questions and remarks, hopefully from the audience.
Yes, we do have questions and remarks from the audience. Thank you so much for sending them in. And you can still do that, by the way. The first one that I have, you kind of already addressed it just now, but I'm going to share it anyways, just so we can enjoy the coincidence. So George asks, couldn't one argue that reconnecting with nature is based on the exact same ideals that separated us from it in the first place? Were we ever really disconnected? So you already spoke about this more or less explicitly, but I don't know if one of you wants to answer in a few words.
Someone has something to add to this. You are ready.
I've spoken.
On this. were we ever really disconnected with nature?
I would say yes and no. I would say many people feel a profound sense of disconnection being in urban environments, in a universe of concrete and steel, and in the COVID crisis, sitting behind screens, not being in touch literally with the rest of the world. I think there's this sense of real disconnection, but at the same time, we are connected. We need food, we breathe the oxygen, we interact with the larger environment all the time. But I think the idea of indeed reconnecting has some artificiality in it, that you maybe it is more a recollecting of a sense of connection that we sort of forgot, that, mm-hmm. that it's always around us, but it's remembering that it is part and parcel of what we are, what we are being.
Pay more attention to it.
Yeah.
The connection that's still there, maybe.
Yeah.
Indeed. Well, thank you for that answer. I think it summarized things nicely. Now, this is for Paula. Your project caused quite a bit of curiosity for this one person. They ask, could it be possible to hear more about what type of rules were co-created during your game of swarms?
Yes. And, yeah. Yes, thank you, because the format's kind of short, so to explain the workshop, sometimes it's difficult because we have like to play, really to understand. But basically, I explained a little bit about the master node, which represents this idea of the individual. So the players could decide together whether like to eliminate or how to use the master node within the network. So it's more related to how you can build a resilient and a robust network. So they basically test the connections. You have like a pair of dice. So they represent like the contingencies, the randomness. And so based on the dice, you have like the number of nodes to add to the board. So the players together could like just add to the board like the nodes and see how to connect to them, also using the master node and also deciding to eliminate or explode the master node. So for instance, I will give an example to not be so abstract. A master node is a master node. Why? Because it concentrates connections. It represents a centralized power. So by the time that you have like a master node that is concentrating connections, if someone goes there and decides, for instance, to explode or to remove this master node, all the connections are lost. And the network basically, yeah, you lose part of the network. So this is the idea about the resilience of the network. So when you have a more distributed network, and then maybe I can refer to blockchain or other more artificial kind of networks, then it's more difficult like to lose the connections and lose the network itself. So they were playing with this concept. Part of the collaborators, they were, like I said, engineers or researchers, so they also have a kind of background and could play with this background. But yeah, basically, that's it. I mean, they created a lot of rules, and yeah, hopefully they will build a network. We are going to experiment with it.
Nice. That was a good example as well. Thank you for explaining that to us. The following question is somewhat related by the same person, but we can also open this up to the others, I think. So they ask, well, they say, excellent idea about the need to limit competition. Do you have more reflections on it? And I would suggest anyone could answer this one as well.
It's quite abstract for me. I don't really have feedback specifically on...
I'm going just to give maybe tell something that happened during the workshops. Mm-hmm. So that there was this person, and when I started like to explain that Game of Swarms was a cooperative game, etc., he started like to question, but why a collaborative game? I mean, a competitive game is much more fun. Like, what am I going to do with all the people and, you know, create rules, etc. And then we started like a conversation about it, and I think he said something like, yes, because we compete, because the world has always been like this, you know, like you must compete to prevail. This is what we were told, right? Most part of the time. So I think that this idea that there is a truth about it, for instance, is something that we should rethink. You know, that it is not the only option.
And maybe this relates also to this idea of not knowing, that maybe part of the unlearning is also involves that seeing how much we are already sort of obsessed, if you will, with competition, that it can only be satisfying or gratifying if there's a competitive element, and that maybe in the collaboration this is a new dimension, maybe a softer quality, or engaging another part of us that we need to appreciate, maybe, or learn to appreciate for its worth. But we come from a background where competition on the job market or any place, race, is all over. So it's very much guiding our experience, and maybe less experience with cooperation.
Yeah. And creating a lot of anxiety also for the individual.
Okay, we have one last question. Thank you for your thoughts on that. This is for Paula as well. How do you view the internet with regards to your, says our audience, Game of Swarms? So what's the relationship between these, maybe?
Well, it has everything to do, I think. I mean, it's interesting because the next phase is supposed to be an online game. So it's being created during these times in which we are basically communicating through digital platforms. And this idea of creating like a swarm, a digital swarm, a swarm online, and having like parts from different countries, and you know, this is, today it's possible. Today it's really possible actually to form like this swarm through the internet, and the internet is kind of a public space as well. So, and it is supposed to be a distributed network, like in this concept, as a public space, so everyone can be there. And of course, that is, it's already controlled, but well, it was born to be a kind of distributed and network.
Great, thank you very much. That's our questions from the audience. Again, thanks for sending them in.
Thank you, Irene. And thanks to our guests, Dr. Jan van Boeckel, Theun Karelse, and Paula and Nishijima. Thanks to them. Yeah. And with this, we've almost come to the end of this third and last theme night of the Media Art Festival. Today we zoomed in on a human relationship with nature and how art reflects on that theme. Yesterday we discussed and played with the force of not knowing, and the day before, the first evening, we talked about culturenomics and the appreciation of culture and the economic value of the cultural sector. So this were the three theme nights. And Irene, you are still there, and you are the curator of the Media Art Festival. You've witnessed all three evenings, and maybe you could, as a wrap-up, elaborate and summarize these three nights in your words. How do you, as a curator, look at these evenings? Where were the connections, and what should we take with us from it in the future?
Sure, I can try.
You can try, yeah.
Yeah, where to start? It's been quite a journey these last 3 days. I will share with you a bit about here and now, which is the theme that encompasses these three nights. This theme was actually chosen more than a year ago, but it became very topical recently, of course, with the coronavirus situation and many other really important events that have happened this year. The original idea was, in media art, we talk about technology and new communication media included there, and art. So we're very often looking at the future. We're working with scientists. We're thinking about where are we going to be, what's going to happen. But when we do that, sometimes it seems that the future is just in one direction, and we lose sight of everything that's happening already in the here and now, so to speak. So the idea was to take a really meditative, reflexive look at what's going on, and not just our individual here and nows, but you know, there are multiple heres and multiple nows for every thing, being, species that is coexisting in this world. So it was a very ambitious idea, of course. We broke it down into three themes. We started with economy on Tuesday. That was so interesting because trying to talk about the value of culture, you have to go right back to the basics. So what is culture anyways? What is art? What is value? And how does the world work? What do we value? What are our systems, our globalized world? Where does money and matter flow? So we started off really strong with that. I really enjoyed both of the talks, and I loved that phrase from the first night that culture is about difference and about the other, and that there's no such thing as art without the other. I think that's something that we've carried forward throughout the days. Yesterday, with the unknown, we looked at these openings, these moments of radical relationship with the other, with the world, with time, with curiosity, with experience. And I think that really goes to the core of why we have art and why we do what we do. And then today, we went straight into the nitty-gritty of these relationships, those people, if I may, that inhabit our world with us. And these conversations flowed in and out with each other. There were connections between the people, but also between the elements that are surrounding us. I think it's always hard to say what you should take away from this night, because of course, art rarely tells you what to do. But for me, I'm thinking about all the stories that we told in these 3 days, all the details that we discovered, all the connections we made. And I'm also thinking about all the stories we didn't tell, everything that's left, everything that's pressing on the here and now. And I think here and now is really a commitment. It's about what kind of things should we care about, and how can we care in radical and open and kind ways. That's what I've been feeling these last 3 days. I don't know if you've been with me, and if not, then I invite you to do that. I know in the comments and among the team, we've had a really exciting time, and I can't wait to carry it forward and see what we do next, hopefully in March 2021.
Thank you very much, Irene. Give her an applause. I have nothing to add to that. With this, we've really come to the end of this third and last theme night of the Media Art Festival. I'll say once again, there's no Media Art Festival at this moment, but the organization is working hard to try and make the festival take place coming year, starting at the 26th of February. So put that date into your agenda, and hopefully we'll see each other then in real life. Corona volente. In the meantime, you are still all very welcome to donate to the Media Art Festival. I should say that again. You can find the link underneath the chat and where the donations can be made, and you are very welcome to do so. For now, I'd like to thank some people. Thanks to the people from the Faber studio here. It's in St. Anna Parochie. Thanks to you guys. Thanks very much for all your work. Thanks to the organization of the Media Art Festival. Thanks for all your work also. Applause for yourself. And a very special thanks to our guest of tonight, Dr. Jan van Boeckel, Paula Nishijima, and Theun Karelse. My name is Anja Toonstra. Thanks for attending tonight, and hope to see you next year at the actual festival. Bye.